Next up is Chef Haley Nguyen. Where's Haley? Come on up, Haley. Give her a big hand. So, Haley, if you were a food, what would you be and why?
I would like to be a hot loaf of bread. No, figurative. No, I just like, I love warm bread. And the reason for that is I think bread brings humanity together regardless of culture. It doesn't matter where you are, you are, a loaf of bread can feed, and it, to me, it's humanity. And so, a loaf of bread.
Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. My food story, I have so many, but I was born and raised in Vietnam, and I came here in 75 at the end of the Vietnam War. And so when we left, I was one of the refugee Hmong people. And so we didn't have, we only had the clothes on our backs. We had nothing, no pictures, no papers, nothing. So growing up, when we came here, my family, we have seven brothers and sisters, my family, we often sit around Thanksgiving, holiday, any holidays, we would reminisce about how we were growing up in Vietnam. And if you ask my mom, we all kind of like, Mom, how was I when I was young? What did I do? And she would say, well, you were probably the most difficult child to feed. About me. And she would tell my kids this. She said, yes, your mom, it was so difficult to feed her. And then my kids were like, Mom, how could you be a picky eater when you don't have a whole lot to eat? How could you be picky? And I don't know why, but my mom said, it's not that you were picky, it was, I just love to go to other people's house and eat. Because to me, I think my house, because we grew up poor, and so the food in our family was very ordinary. It was just rice and some vegetables and maybe pieces of fish. And so to me, that was just not very exciting. And so I would always go to neighbor's house and see what's going on over there. And so my mom said that she would have to really actually pay other children in the neighborhood to pretend they were eating. She would give them my bowl of rice and said, here's some pennies. If you pretend to eat it, she would probably come and ask you to eat with you. And that's how I would eat. And so I would go to the neighbors, and the kids would just say, hey, you want some? It's my bowl of rice. And that's how she said, that's how she fed me. So my story is, and I can remember this so distinctively, I love fruit from a tree. Any fruit from a tree, I just love to pick fruit from the tree. So there was a tamarind tree in our neighborhood, huge tree. And I always wait for the fruit to get ripened and would drop onto the ground. I was small, I was about 9 or 10. Couldn't climb the tree, so just wait for the fruit to drop and then you pick them up and then, you eat it. So there was a lady that lived right there by that tree, and she never comes out of her house, ever. Growing up, I always see the kids would come and kind of throw rocks at her house, and her house is a thatched hut, and so she never came out. We never knew who she was, and so there's rumors in the neighbors that this lady is a crazy woman, you don't want to go in there. She's like one of these, you hear stories, she'll a witch or whatever. And so my mom said, you're not allowed to go into her house, and the kids would throw rocks at her and just kind of really taunted her. So one day, I was waiting for the tamarind tree to drop, and I thought, maybe I'll just knock on the door and see, maybe she's cooking something inside. Maybe there'll be something good to eat inside. So I did. I came in, I knocked on the door. She opened the door, and her house is really dark. She only has a candle, and she's really dark. So I came in, she asked me to come in. I came in, and she said, are you hungry? I said, yes. And she said, okay, sit down. I'm going to be cooking dinner. And so I sat down, and she was making some pork in the clay pot, my favorite. Nice. And I thought, yes, I just hit the jackpot, So I'm staying. And of course I sat there, and she said, okay, you wash the pork?
Yeah.
pot for me. You watch it, just sit there and watch it, make sure it's not burning. I said, okay, I'll do that. I just sit there and watch that. And she pulled out the mat on the floor, and I still remember her. She would put the mat down, and she got this contraption out, this long glass contraption out. And she gathered some, I can't remember what she was gathering, her little wooden box. And she would lay down on the mat on one side. And she started smoking. And I sat there and I watched her smoke. And it was almost like ceremonious sort of a thing that they do. And so she got, I mean, she lay everything out, you know, she got really relaxed and she took her time and she just kind of lay down on the floor on the mat. And I sat there and I watched this lady and she got this little tar black thing and she put it into this little glass bomb. And yes, and so I said that I watched her smoke this, and she actually drifted off for a while, and I sat there. Now, I made sure the pork did not burn, because I made sure the pork did not burn, so I sat there and watched it, and she just kind of drifted off, and I sat there and I waited. I waited because, you know, you do not eat somebody else's food when you're in their house. So she woke up and we had dinner together. I left, I came back home. My mom didn't know where I was. Never told her the story. Many years later, when I watched Indochine, then I know it was opium. Yes. So, and I told my mom this, and she said, at that time, if you knew you went in there, you would have gotten the spanking of your life. So I said nothing, but in the many, many years later, that's when I realized that my life, growing up during the war, this is sort of the thing that was happening. But it was always food that I was looking for. And it just happenstance when I run into things like this lady who was opium smoker, and I just come in and have dinner with her, and I thought she was really nice. I mean, you know, I didn't know anything, and I didn't know anything about smoking, or it was just kind of a sort of interesting thing to watch, you know, when she's starting to do all this thing, but she made a really great pot of pork. I mean, she really did. It was a little sweet, a little salty. Now, you know, my mom, she's a decent cook. My grandmother's better, but my mother, she cooks, but her palate's a little salty. And so most of her food gets to be a little salty a lot of times for my taste. But because we're a northerner, and southern Vietnamese people tend to put a little more sugar, so they're a little saltier and sweeter in their food, right? For those of you who've been to Vietnam, and so that's the taste, and that's what I love. But for me, growing up, it's always somebody's house that has great food other than mine, you know? And the fruit thing now, and then we fast forward to my life in America, as far as food. When we settled in Indiana because we were sponsored by a Catholic church in Indiana. We stayed in the camp in Pennsylvania. And I remember that my very first dinner in Indiana town where this church sponsored us came there. And we were scared, we were hungry, we didn't know where we were. We were sponsored by a church in a farm town in southern Indiana. And so when we got there, the welcome dinner was stuffed green pepper. We don't have green peppers in Vietnam. And I thought that was the oddest thing, was stuffed green bell peppers. But to this day, if I live in Irvine, and if I still see fruit trees that's kind of hanging over the you know, the sidewalk, I would want to tend to really want to pick it. And one of the greatest things that I see in Orange County, and I love, I moved from Indiana to Colorado, and then gradually moved out here. But when I moved out here, I saw, oh my gosh, banana blossom. You know, there's banana trees here, and there's banana blossom. And I don't know if you ever seen a beautiful banana blossom. It's just one of those really gorgeous things. But for me, it's not just the blossom itself. It's actually life. It's food. It feeds. And it brings life. And so for me, when I look at all the fruit tree, banana blossom, the citrus, anything, for me, it means life. And I think that's, my life is still pretty much, I don't think that I have gone over picking fruit at other people's house. So when I walk with my son, especially, and I say, can you just pick that one? Just hand it over, it's really kind of public. But like I said, Mom, I'm pretty sure that that's not public property.
It's pomegranate.
Is that what it is?
Okay. It's a pomegranate.
Okay. And so for me, it's the memory, the story for me is all of that. The American culture, and I'm very blessed because I have both worked, the East and West. And when I came here, we don't really celebrate Thanksgiving. But living with the priest, he had a housekeeper, we call her Aunt Marie. And she was the one that taught my mom and us how to make fried chicken. And she was the one that really, living in Southern Indiana, really actually taught me what America really is, middle of America, all this tradition. And so I'm very lucky and very blessed. And but thank you for having me.
Beautiful story.